Welcome to the Metalverse. I'm here with Scott Slaughter Snyder to take fans on a tour of DC's Dark Multiverse.
Thanks for having me. I'm so excited to be here. Thanks to everybody tuning in. We're really, really thrilled to give you this tour of this nutty event that we've been working on.
Great. Scott, you left fans on a heck of a cliffhanger when you finished your last Justice League story last year. So tell us how things have changed for the Justice League since then, and what does this new world look like?
Well, first of all, I just want to say thanks to everybody for supporting this one. I know it's crazy out there, and we wanted to give you something fun and over the top, and the way the fans have showed up for it, just it means the world to me and Greg and the whole team, all these great creators that you're about to see that are working on the whole event, and Marie herself, our rock queen. So thank you so, so much. Essentially, the Batman Who Laughs has taken over everything, and he's been given the power to reshape the DC universe so it almost looks like one big continent that's a bat. And he's moved the locations around, so Gotham covers almost the entire continent, or the entire span of North America. Meanwhile, Arkham Asylum has its own whole kingdom, and there's a Valley of Fallen Rings, and it's Starro Land, and all kinds of stuff. So it's a really, really fun DCU, even though it's completely like a hellscape being terrorized by the Batman Who Laughs and his hundreds and hundreds of evil Batman. So he's pulled all of these evil versions of Bruce Wayne, some of them like a dark side Batman, another one like a Cthulhu Batman, a wizard Batman, all from the Dark Multiverse to help him rule over the heroes. So it's a really, really transformed DCU. It's very very different, but we also, I think it's incredibly fun. So we're really excited about it.
So what are some of your favorite places? Is like Starro Land your favorite place? Or would it be Jarro Land?
I do love the Valley of Starro, but I'd have to say my favorite place is probably Castle Bat, which is the headquarters of our Batman Who Laughs himself. And it is a living castle that is itself a dark evil Batman, where he's from a world where he infused his own soul into the bricks of Gotham, but something went wrong. And so he's essentially this twisted, crazy version of Gotham that has Bruce Wayne's evil mind in it. So it's almost like a living city that can change and transform. So the castle itself is a sentient evil Batman. So I love that location. And I'd have to say my second favorite one is probably New Apocalypse, which is a new version of the fourth world planet Apocalypse, where all of the heroes are being kept in prison by the Batman Who Laughs, and it's inside the sun. And the person that has to keep it running the whole time is Superman, who's also in chains there. So he's got long hair, he's been exposed to all of this anti-life, and apparently it makes you grow your hair really long. And he's got a dark side arm, and he just looks amazing. Greg Capullo's design for him just to me is like, he looks like an awesome hair metal Superman that I just love. I want a toy so bad.
So Castle Bat is not the only thing that's sentient and alive. This entire project is evolving as we make it. Mm-hmm. And that's in part because of what's inside your brain and Greg's brain, but also because we have a lot of collaborators on this. And before we bring on some of these collaborators, has there been anything in the Metalverse that has taken you by surprise because you didn't even know it was coming because there's so many people doing creative things on this project?
Oh yeah, let me just say also, like, the lineup of creators that agreed to be part of this project just blew us away. I mean, I was always hoping that people would be excited to kind of rock out with us, but the fact that we have some comic industry legends and some incredibly bright up-and-comers all together, we wanted this to feel like one big celebration, one big rock concert of comic awesomeness. And it really, everyone really came through. So there's so many surprises, from the way that Daniel Warren Johnson handled the living Bat Monster truck, Batmo Beast, to what Becky Cloonan did with Aquaman and the Black Fleet. Everything made it, basically everyone's participation, I feel, made it better than I could have or the team could have alone. So we're really, really grateful. For me, if there's a character that surprised me that I really enjoy writing, it's Sergeant Rock. He narrates the whole event, because at the end of the day, what we want this story to be is, it's a war story. It's about how ultimately we're all in this together as an industry, as fans, retailers, everybody, you know, editors, Marie, like all of us are in it together to get this industry through tough times to the other side, to become something better, something that can really face the future. bravely and proud of itself. So in that way, having such a great roster of characters and having the story almost told from the point of view of a warrior who just says, get up, we're gonna get through this, feels right. So we're really proud of how it all came together.
Scott, let's bring on a few of those collaborators now. Let's bring on Joshua the Wicked Williamson and James the Tormentor Tynan.
I feel like that's appropriate for James.
Yeah, no, that is very appropriate.
And
I am honored. I mean, you
know, who doesn't like musical theater?
So the three of you have been collaborating on this story since before Dark Knight's Metal even launched. It's been years building up to this story. What's this new map? Like, we made a new world now, and the new map of the multiverse or the metalverse. What does it mean to you to see it all realized like this? What excites you?
I mean, with working with Scott and James, I mean, really, it's been one of the best experiences I've ever had in comics. You know, we've been developing this stuff literally for years. You know, you're going back to, like, us having lunch with the editors back at San Diego Comic-Con 2016 and starting to talk about this stuff then and building this stuff out. And really, to see it, it's really just, it's awesome. You know, it's one of the best things I've done at DC, and just be able to see all the stuff and work with these people, it's been really great. And now to see this map and to see this world we're building, it's terrific. And like what Scott was saying earlier, one of the best parts of building all this stuff is now we get to share with other people, not just share with the audience, you know, and we're very thankful and love it, they're loving it, but also be able to share with all these different creators. It's been really awesome.
Just to jump on that, like, honestly, the thing that's most exciting about seeing the Metalverse map is that it's actually seeing something that we just wrote on the corner of a whiteboard like a while ago. It's like, what if we actually made a map, like, of this whole crazy DC universe? And I remember the exact email where, because for a while we were talking about, well, what do we do with the existing continents and all of that? And it's like, what if it's just a big map that looks like a bat? And it's like, oh man, that's so cool. Yeah. And so much of this has come from moments of just like enthusiasm and excitement for the utter lunacy and fun and DC lore that all meeting together and forming this project. So it's been a dream come true.
Can we talk just a little bit about the one shots? So like Josh is on Speed Metal, James is on Multiverse's End, Scott's on Trinity Crisis, and the three of you collaborated on The Darkest Night. Josh, what can fans expect from Speed Metal?
So Speed Metal is a crazy race across the Metalverse. You know, we have this insane landscape that we've built, and you get to see the Flash family race across it as they're running away from the Darkest Night. Wally has the power of Manhattan in him, and the Darkest Night wants that power. And so he's going to chase them until the Speed Force burns out. It was funny, at first, James was actually going to write Speed Metal at one point, and I had to privately email him and be like, dude, I have a huge favor to ask, because since I'm leaving the Flash book, I wanted to make sure I got to write Wally one more time. And I wrote this like whole impassioned thing to James about how important it was to me to write Speed Metal. James was like, oh, I thought you were already writing it. So it just worked out. I was able to do it. But yeah, working with Eddie Barros on it's been really great stuff. But yeah, it's just epic. Just this epic adventure. It's one of my favorite things I've gotten to do for DC. It's one of my favorite Flash issues. But I really, getting to tell a story about Barry and Wally and them coming out of Death Metal and going on this insane race to try to, I don't know how much spoilers we can get into on this stuff, but what they're racing for, how important they're racing, what they're trying to do, just trying to stay ahead of the Darkest Night and then making a decision of Flash don't run from things. They run two things. The Flashes run to danger, and then realizing that they're running from the Darkest Night when they should be running right at him.
Are they also in your Justice League crossovers?
No, Justice League crossover mostly focuses on Lex Luthor, and it's a great team of people. They're on this mission spinning out Death Metal 3. They're all on a mission to go save the Legion of Doom and destroy Perpetua's throne. And it's Lex Luthor, Nightwing, Cyborg, Starfire, Detective Chimp, and Martian Manhunter and Hawkgirl. And it's this awesome team, and they're having fun. There's a lot of really crazy stuff in there. The Valley of Starro is a really big part of that story. It's just, I think one of the things you get to see with them is they actually traverse. They actually get to explore a little bit of the map of Metalverse, and we see different locations. Like, you see the Slaughter Swamps, where it's basically like Bloodhaven has become just totally covered in these swamps. You get to see a little bit of the Arkham Wastelands. You get to see Valley of Starro and just different places within. So, yeah, all this stuff is really fun to write. All these characters and these experiences, and you get to show them in kind of unique, different settings we normally get to see them in.
So, James the Tormentor. I know you gave up the right to write speed metal. Instead, you got Multiverse's End. What can you tell us about that one shot?
Well, honestly, it's really the payoff of a lot of the work that I was doing with Scott on Justice League. This is something that my favorite issues of Justice League to write were the ones that dealt with the total, like, cosmic insanity of DC lore, like the deep dive weird stuff. And so when one of these issues came up, and we realized we needed to actually show what's happening outside of our universe in the multiverse, we need to show what's the devastation that's being wrecked across the entire multiverse, I was like, yes, I very much want to write that issue. So the one angle of it, because this, it does pick up threads that come directly out of Death Metal number 3, but the one, like, you know, fanboy geek angle that I was very excited about in this issue is that in an event that's overrun with evil Batman, the character who I really wanted to get his point of view was Owlman, the original evil Batman of the DC multiverse, who is really, really pissed off that there are all of these evil Batmen overwhelming this Earth back, overwhelming the original, the center of the multiverse. So that was sort of the way in. We've got amazing art coming in from Juan Gideon, and this is going to be a really, really, really fun issue. I really can't wait for people to get their hands on it.
Scott Slaughter Snyder, how are you going to top that with Trinity Crisis?
I don't know. I mean, these guys have been incredible bandmates. You know, we became friends years and years and years ago, and to get to work with them and to work with everybody else that you guys are going to be talking to has really been the highlight of my time at DC. So, you know, everything that you like about the event probably came from them or from the other people you're going to be speaking to. And I just try not to mess it up. But Trinity Crisis is super fun. It's something I've wanted to do for a long time. And it was in the very first kernels of what we pitched when we pitched Death Metal. The idea is basically that to win in this story, Wonder Woman believes that the heroes have to travel into the dark multiverse where the original DC crises are still happening, take the energy from those crises and use it to destroy the Batman who laughs in Perpetua and rebuild the multiverse, started over the way it should be started. So Trinity Crisis really focuses on this team of heroes: Wonder Woman, Batman, who's Lord of the Dead at this point, Superman, Jaro, spoiler, Swamp Thing, and Harley Quinn and Jonah Hex, infiltrating Castle Bat and going down through a portal beneath it into the dark multiverse and seeing whether or not these crisis worlds are really what they think they're going to be, and taking that energy and trying to win. So it's got incredible action. It's drawn by Francis Manapul, who's one of my close friends and Justice League collaborators, and is just knocking it out of the park. And it's an issue that's really about what a crisis is, you know, why they're so important to DC history, what they signify. And this one, why the whole event is called an anti-crisis, right? That's Death Metal, an anti-crisis. So for us, it takes that concept and spins it on its head. So there will be some big surprises once you actually get into the dark. It won't be what you expect, but it will bring back the characters that you are expecting from Darkseid and Superboy Prime and Anti-Monitor and all the kind of characters affiliated with those, you know, big DC crises. They're going to come back in ways that I think will surprise and delight and horrify people. So I'm excited for that.
And the three of you together are working on The Darkest Night. Mm-hmm. Where does that story take place, and who is The Darkest Night?
So The Darkest Night, spoiler, is the new evolved iteration of the Batman Who Laughs. After Wonder Woman cuts him in half with the chainsaw of truth at the end of issue 1. And I feel like everything I say, I can't believe. I'm like, is this really a story we're doing? But it's one of my favorite moments that I've ever written. She, like, just totally chops him in half with this invisible chainsaw that has the lasso as its cord. Once he's dead, it's been part of his plan to have his mind put into the body of a being that was a Bruce Wayne that was affected by the machine that made Dr. Manhattan. So it's his Batman Who Laughs mind or brain put by strange evil Alfreds into the body of basically a Dr. Manhattan Batman, so a Bat-Manhattan. And then once he rises, he decides what form to take. And our issue, The Darkest Night, or our section of that issue, it's a guide to all the evil Batman or some of the evil Batman in the Metalverse, tells you why he chose the form he chooses. So it's a really, it's quite powerful, I think, as an issue. I really love it. Tony Daniel drew it, who's another good friend and partner, and he just killed it. And these guys did a great job. So the other thing I'd say too is just that the reason that we did these ones is we wanted to make sure that we were getting off on kind of doing some of the initial pieces, the initial jumping off points together, so that we could give room, honestly, past that to a lot of other creators to come in and join the party. So I'm really excited we got to do these, and also the ways that in which this allowed us to create more space and more room for other people to come in and party with us down the line.
Anything to add to that? James, Josh?
It looks
it's really cool.
Yeah, Tony Daniel did an awesome job on it. It looks really cool. There's like, I don't know, the art he did on that Darkest Night one is really great.
My favorite part in working on this is there's a two-page spread in there where, you know, he's sort of where we see all of these other evil Batmen, some of the worst evil Batmen in the Dark Multiverse, and coming up with those evil Batmen and then seeing Tony draw them was the most fun part of that issue.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun.
You're a paper doll. I'll fold you how I want. You're not my noose. I tie this knot. Scars on my fingers, bruises my neck, crashing my chains, washing my wreck.
We have all these collaborators waiting to tell us about their part of this project. We have Kari, like Atari, Fury, Fist, Randolph.
Hello.
And then we've got Christopher Blood Rain Priest.
Hi, how you doing?
Riley the God Killer Rossmo is with us.
Oh, hi.
That sounded very God Killer, Riley. we have Jamal the Obliterator Eigel.
Konnichiwa.
And Joelle Bludgeoning Jones.
Yeah.
Very bludgeoning, Joelle. Kari, can you tell us a little bit? I know you worked on Harley Quinn. Can you tell us a little bit about where in this Metalverse the story takes place and who are the major players?
Yes. Our story, it's a short little fun thing. Me and Chip Zdarsky worked on a Harley Quinn story where she's wandering through a post-apocalyptic nuclear wasteland looking for the missing Suicide Squad. And she comes across a band of, we'll call them mutants. And it being Harley Quinn, you know, hijinks ensue.
That sounds great. And then let's go visit another part of this Metalverse.
Yes.
Where does your story take place and who are the major players?
I have no idea.
That's not true.
It takes place somewhere in Gotham, but Gotham is everything in this wild, wacky Metalverse there. So somewhere in Gotham, and Batman teams up with Jonah Hex, who Batman has a Black Lantern ring. And the Black Lantern ring has these properties that it can bring people back from the dead. It won't bring people back from the dead. It will reanimate corpses. Excuse me. So he reanimates Jonah Hex to serve a certain purpose that I can't tell you without spoiling the story. But Jonah is basically there to nag Batman and be Batman's conscience, and keep Batman on the right path as they make their way to the hall of to the Crypt of Heroes.
I really hope that we get a Jonah Hex zombie action figure.
Okay, and the unexpected benefit of doing this story was I had my first chance to work with this brilliant Eduardo Risso, who just blew me away. The artwork is just incredible on this story, and the art and the color, and I had a great time with him, and hope we get a chance to work with him again one day.
Let's move on to Riley the God Killer Rossmo. Hi, Riley. What can you tell us about Robin King? I mean, I don't think he's even Robin, but he is a king.
He is. He's so, as Batman needs Robin, the Batman Who Laughs has a multitude of evil Robins, but Robin King is actually a Bruce Wayne, a 12-year-old Bruce Wayne who is the worst. He's the worst of the worst of the worst, and we're going to see Bruce Wayne do some pretty crazy things before he's invited to become the Robin King.
Who wrote that one?
Pete Tomasi. Pete's a super genius. He's really smart. He's the best. We had a ton of fun on it, and there's some stuff in there that I didn't know we'd be allowed to do.
Great. Awesome. Let's check in with Jamal the Obliterator. I would like to know more about this dinosaur.
Well, I got to work with Marguerite Bennett for the first time, which was a joy. And the story takes place on a dark and stormy night and features a giant animatronic T-Rex known as B-Rex, and was actually introduced way back in 1946 in Batman number 35. But our version is basically Batman uploaded his brain into the T-Rex. So we get to know a little bit more about this imposing figure with very tiny arms.
Going from the oldest evil Batman now to the newest evil Batman, Joel Bludgeoning Jones. What is your brand new evil Batman? And who are the major players in your story?
Mine's really bizarre. It's Garth Ennis wrote it, and it's a baby Batman. So an old Batman conducted an experiment, turned himself into a baby, and he's gonna roll around the Batcave with fat, pudgy fingers and a big head.
So basically, is he saying all babies are evil? Is that the message here?
I don't know. I don't have any babies, and I've never drawn babies. But I guess in this story, that's his take. So.
Thanks, everyone, for participating in this event. And thank you so much for being part of Death Metal. This has been an honor to work with every one of you. Thanks so much. Bye, guys.
Bye.
Loma Vista Recordings and executive producer Tyler Bates are creating a soundtrack for the comic. Did you know that, Scott?
I did. It was a big secret. And the people they've lined up to be a musical part of this whole project, from Marilyn Manson to Zach Wilde to Greg Capullo himself, who's going to be playing guitar on this thing. It's going to be awesome. Wait till you see. I always knew Greg was good, but it's out of control. And so I'll be playing cowbell. It's going to be awesome. You should pick it up. And thank you guys so much for everything. We really appreciate it. We'll all rock out together.
Here to kill me and dance on my grave. Lucky for me, you don't kill.
I don't dance either, but I'll make an exception in your case.
Bruce, you are one of a kind. Kill him.
I didn't know there were villains left in the world above to imprison here. To be a way back, to turn it all back.
Come on, the fight is happening now. One last fight. Everyone together. We need to fight him like this, Diana. It's what I came to show you. Street battles, small wins, save the ones we can.
The world up there is ruled by Batman. So to me, down here really is Paradise Island. What? Just standing there? Not fighting back? The brave men and women buried here, they'd be disappointed. I mean, what would you say to them right now?
Just one word, really. Rise. Do I hear drums? Elixir of life, my spirit, now scarred and mangled.